Good evening, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to the Monday night seminar. Thank you for all coming out on a Thursday night, and it's the non-traditional night for us to have the seminar here at the Lavabo. But we wanted to switch things around a little bit this week because we have a visitor from across the pond, and so to accommodate international travel schedules, we thought we could bump things around just a bit and do it on Thursday instead. Before I introduce the speaker, I do have an announcement that I need to make, which has to do with the artwork that's on the walls. So this is part of an exhibit called Afterlives of Natural History by Dennis Deffenbaugh. So we're actually going to have the official opening with the artists here on the 24th, on Monday, 7:30 here. And so if you'd like to meet the artist and hear a little bit about how this sort of really unusual effect is done, please come there. All I know is it has to do with Polaroid and a special aging process, which I don't know exactly what that is, but the artist can tell you about that. But it gives these really stunningly unusual and gripping sort of visual effects. So I think that would be really interesting. And so with that, any other announcements or anything before we move on? We're live streaming is one thing to announce, and so in addition to the those of you in this room, we have 200 to 500 other people across the globe, not to put any extra pressure on our speaker, but so if you could do this in as many languages as possible, that would really help. So with that, I would like to introduce Dr. Joseph Tobias, who comes to us from Oxford. Excuse me, the Edward Gray Institute of Ornithology at Oxford. And before that, Dr. Tobias was at Cambridge, where he earned his PhD working with Nick Davies, spent a few years working in bird conservation for various NGOs, particularly doing tropical conservation work, and then assumed his current position at Oxford, where he's been studying sexual selection and selection on sexual signals and community ecology and various sorts of interrelated topics of that sort, some of which he'll be telling us about today. And the title for Joe's talk today is Social Selection and the Evolution of Ornaments in Males and Females. Joe.
Thank you very much, Mike. Good evening, all. Thank you for coming along. Thank you very much for the invite as well. It's very nice to be giving a talk here at the Lab of Ornithology, coming, as Mike said, from the main ornithology lab on the European side of things. I feel quite at home crossing the pond to another ornithology lab, but it's an honour to be here giving this talk. Thanks for coming along. The talk that I'm going to be giving is going to focus on the general topic of bird ornamentation, something that interests everybody from the casual lay bird observer to scientists of every stripe. It's always interested people. The ornamentation of plumage in birds of paradise and various birds attracts lots of people to bird watching in the first place. And there are some pretty dominant paradigms in terms of how people explain why things are ornamented. And it's normally, over the history of ornithology, been very much focused on the male, male-biased ornamentation and explanations for that. And so the focus of this talk is going to be slightly different, about a very common phenomenon that we actually understand much less well, and that is ornamentation in both sexes, often mutually ornamented, like these great crested grebes, where there's no real difference in ornamentation between the sexes. And in some cases, sex-biased sex role reverse species with female ornamentation. That, in fact, is relatively better understood. So it's really the focus, my focus now is going to be on these more balanced systems, the extent to which the old venerable idea of sexual selection proposed by Darwin gives us a good framework for understanding why female birds and loads of species that we might see around us in the environment, why they are also ornamented, often as ornamented as males, or is there something different going on? Is selection different? Context and mechanisms of selection, do they differ between the sexes? So that's the basic framework outlined for what I'm going to be talking about tonight. As with most things in this field, they go back to the writings of Charles Darwin, possibly before that, but he was certainly the first to set the framework, the conceptual framework of selection. So I don't want to go into this in too much detail, but just to lay out the field in terms of what people think or how they subdivide sources of selection and how they relate to ornaments. Of course, Darwin came up with his big idea, natural selection, published in 1869 or whatever it was, why gradual evolution would take place in populations as the process of selection through increased fitness of those individuals that were best suited to their environment would hone the phenotypes of species to be perfectly suited to their environment in terms of their ecological niche. This was obviously a big idea at the time. We now know it to be a very good explanation for how things evolve. But Darwin always had a problem with ornaments. Everything was reducing costs or reducing mortality. But what about ornaments, these costly, elaborate plumages? He did talk a lot about birds in his writings. What was going on there? He knew that was a problem for his theory. And 10 years later, he came up with another treatise where he introduced the idea of sexual selection. This wasn't the environment shaping the phenotype of birds and other organisms. It was mechanisms such as female choice or competition between males that would explain why the nightingale had such a superb song or the peacock had such a splendid tail. These were things that didn't fit natural selection. They were too costly. The environment wasn't producing them. They had to be something else. And so sexual selection was his idea. Female choice and male-male competition. And that really has been the structure that has survived with us for many decades since then. And it's still the dominant viewpoint today. And it does very well in lots of systems. Here are some birds that will be familiar to all of you. A Chinese import to here and Britain, the ring-necked pheasant. I saw lots of those this morning in game farms, not too far outside here, so I know you all know those ones. It's a highly polygynous species. Males mate with lots of females, and it's easy to see why a male is strongly ornamented. Males don't choose females at all. They're promiscuous and polygynous. So it's a very strongly sexually selected system. It fits Darwin's idea very nicely. Nobody has a problem with something like the pheasant or many other game birds, catingas, birds of paradise. Those are male-biased ornaments, which are driven by Darwin's classic ideas of sexual selection. It works in socially monogamous species. Here's another import that I'm sure you're all pleased about. We've provided you with the English sparrow, which is much less pronounced in its ornamentation in the male, and that makes sense. They're not as polygamous as pheasants, and there is female choice for ornamented males, but it's much subdued. But it still makes sense in the sexual selection framework. But what then of many other species? This one native to both our countries, the barn swallow, almost equally ornamented in males and females. And in that case, many questions have arisen about why females are ornamented. Why are they? Do they have these long tails? Are males choosing the females? Very little evidence that they are. And in that case, why are the females paying the cost for this, these tail feathers? Is there mutual mate choice? Is there some form of difference, contrast in selection on the ornamental plumage of the male and the female? These are areas that have generated quite a bit of controversy lately, and they're rather important because there's a large component of birds in the world which are of this type, mutually ornamented or similarly ornamented in both sexes. And my feeling is that we still have a very poor understanding or poor framework for understanding why that pattern plays out so often. So these cases of female ornamentation and the idea of cooperation over reproduction, have been sources of conflict and criticism of the sexual selection idea from Julian Huxley in 1934, focusing on the grebes that I showed at the outset, to Joan Roughgarden, a paper more recently about a rather different idea, but focusing on whether species are actually cooperating, the sexes are actually cooperating, and that sexual selection might not be a very explanatory framework. That's quite a contentious idea in itself, but it's just to give us an indication of the difficulties posed by these more egalitarian or mutually ornamented systems, and the fact that they've generated quite a bit of controversy over the years. Nothing as much has changed. That is, the sexual selection idea still remains the dominant paradigm. Any critique of it is very strongly resisted because it's a very popular idea and clearly works in a lot of cases and obviously is useful. But it'd be something worth, and it's certainly the target of a lot of recent research to explore or at least question some of the generalities of the sexual selection idea. So that's, I want to go a little bit deeper into some of those questions in this talk. What I'm going to focus on is whether sexual selection works as an explanation for female ornamentation, and do mechanisms of selection more likely differ between the sexes. Quite a bit of evidence that they do, and I'll present some of that hopefully without needing to go into too much depth. And because of these potential differences, do we need to change the way we think about the role of natural and sexual selection as drivers of phenotypic evolution? And there's been some recent proposals to slightly change that dyadic framework of, or contrasting binary framework of natural and sexual selection. So I'll explain a little bit of recent thinking about that. That might help us to understand bird ornaments a little bit more clearly. So what were the traditional views? Darwin was very clear about the matter. Sexual selection applied to males. They're always more limited by mates than are females. This is the theme that went through his writings. He saw that as a good explanation for why males are more eager, in his words, than females, and why therefore males were more commonly ornamented. He admitted that the reverse was often true, and in sexual reverse species, he was very aware of phalaropes and dotterels and the like, and he was very happy to concede that that was sexual selection, just a mirror image of it, where the females were basically males in disguise. All other examples, like the swallows or any other female ornaments, he viewed as something he called transference, which we would call something like genetic correlation now. Selection was happening on the males, and then the ornament was in the females just as a byproduct. There was nothing happening in terms of selection in the females. They were just had the ornament that was evolved in the males. So that was a somewhat one-eyed view of the situation, in keeping with the general worldview of Darwin's day. And what empirical evidence do we have to support those ideas? Well, we know for sure that things like phalaropes and gobies, Darwin was right. Sexual reversed species, there is strong sexual selection on female ornaments through male choice of those ornaments and female-female competition. So no problem there. We don't have to worry about sexual selection as an explanation for why female phalaropes are far more ornamented than males. Perfectly nice explanation for that. What about the genetic correlation ideas? Early models, theoretical models, indicated, so this is going back to around 1980, indicated that female ornaments would evolve just through correlation with strong selection in males. So even by 1980, it was quite generally thought that most female ornaments were because of selection in males, which now seems quite surprising. And indeed, quite a few empirical studies looking for, experimentally testing why females were ornamented, couldn't really find a clear selection mechanism. And again, this continued to support the idea that female ornaments weren't adaptive. They were just accidental byproducts of male ornaments. Getting further into the 1990s and more recently, there's been a lot more focus on mutually ornamented systems, like the blue-footed boobies showing off their blue feet to each other and the crests of the crested auklet. And in all these cases, it's been quite well demonstrated that males choose females on the basis of their ornaments as well. So mutual sexual selection, a bit more of a balanced system. Is this enough of an explanation for why you get these grebe-like systems with ornaments in both sexes? It may be. It certainly seems a little bit more complex than that, looking at some studies of fish and also birds, showing that both dominant mechanisms of selection occur in females as well as males. So it's not just male choice of females, but it's female-female competition. So slightly more information suggesting that female ornaments are shaped by both dominant sexual selection ideas. Not only the choice of the male for the female, making her more elaborately ornamented, but also females fighting between each other, female-female competition mediated by these dominant signals, ornaments. So that seems to give us a picture where sexual selection in females is exactly the same as sexual selection in males. That's where we've got so far. The problem then is that more and more information is coming out about why selection on female ornaments differs. The main tendency being that females use they fight amongst each other, not over males. Males are tending to, the big thing for males is access to matings, females choosing them as a mating partner. Whereas in females, they tend not to be fighting over access to males. There's a difference there. They tend to be competing over resources that are linked to fecundity, so food or territories or resources that will be used for their young or safety for their young. So this is where you start getting contrasts between the targets or the focus of what males and females are competing over. Lots of examples about how these things vary have come to light. I'm going to move beyond the world of birds. I hope nobody minds. A few insect and mammal examples coming up. So if we look at dung beetles, the males use their horns to compete for dung, and their dung that they're competing over is used to attract females. Again, this fits in with Darwin's idea. They are their modus operandi is entirely rooted in attracting a female. The females, however, use horns to compete for dung balls, but they don't want to attract males with them. It's a bit later in the breeding cycle. The dung balls that they're fighting over are entirely for food for their offspring. So here we have that, the distinction or contrast that I was talking about. It's the same genetics and developmental pathway, the same ornament or weapon in this case, but they're used in slightly different ways. The target of competition is somewhat different between the sexes. Loads of examples of this coming out. Quite an interesting one is the social wasps, where aggression mediated by signals on the face, facial markings on these paper wasps, are important in males, and they are fighting for position in lekking areas or position in breeding sites and the target of selection, as is very common among males and across a lot of systems, is matings, access to females. The females also compete among each other, mediated by the same face markings, but they're not after males. They're looking for nest sites and food for reproduction. And the interesting thing there is their nest sites are completely away from the males. They've bred already, and they set up these colonies or nest sites. There's not even any males around, so we know that very well that they're not competing over males. It's a competition system entirely focused on resources for the offspring. So, nice example of the contrast again between the sexes. A few more examples: sheep. Males, use their horns during the rut to compete over access to females. Females don't even bother fighting at that time. Well after their mating, when they drop their lambs, then they start fighting over foraging territories for their young. So they have the horns, and so they carry the cost of the weapon, but the fitness benefit to the female is all about fecundity and the young. Elephant seals, similarly, the males are aggressive in pursuit of the females. The females only start fighting when they're defending space for their pups. So this is a very common theme across lots of different branches of the tree of life. Another interesting example is Clectus parrots, gorgeous things with reverse sexual dichromatism. You might imagine at a glance that the male is on the right, but that is the female. And the male competes over females, but the female, the main target of competition there is nest holes. And it's thought that the plumage is in part a dominant signal over these contests over nest holes. So you get papers like the one I list at the bottom there, raising this problem. Female finery is not for males, is the title of that paper in Tree in 2006. and this was at the beginning of some of these arguments about whether it is sexual selection that's driving ornamentation in these female eclectus parrots. Is it sexual selection when Darwin was so focused on matings being the key aspect of sexual selection? This has nothing to do with matings, it's about nest holes and somewhere to put your young. So there's at least a semantic issue there that needs to be resolved, and it might run deeper than that, or I would argue that that's the case. Darwin, just to recap on that, he was very clear. Sexual selection is just competition for matings. Natural selection, even if it's selection on primary sexual structures, gonads, etc., traits adapted for protecting and feeding offspring, he was very clear. That's not sexual selection, that's natural selection. It's not about seeking mating. So he would not have called the selection on the eclectus parrot or any of the females in the slides that I've just shown sexual selection. So you might have the same trait, but in both sexes, but the selection mechanism, as described by Darwin, would be different. So that's the problem. Same trait appears to evolve sexual selection in males, but in something else, natural selection in females. And this is it jars with most people. How can a socially mediated form of selection produce the same trait, but one is sexual selection, the other is natural selection? It just doesn't sit very comfortably with most people. But it's very widespread. That argument of sexual selection in males versus natural selection in females producing the same trait, I found it in papers on birdsong, horns in bovids, weapons in beetles. This issue is out there quite commonly. People struggle to put the female mechanism as sexual selection, so they call it natural selection. And this is getting to the root of some of the arguments I'm going to lay out in the rest of the talk. Main thing being an alternative solution, moves towards the idea of sexual selection. There's two options, really. Somebody like Tim Clutton Brock, famous evolutionary biologist based in Cambridge, he's a bastion of sexual selection thinking and very uncomfortable with the idea that sexual selection isn't a good explanation for some of these things, and he may well be right. His viewpoint would be all selection processes operating through intersexual competition for breeding opportunities in both sexes, so fecundity, whatever the things I was talking about, it's all sexual selection. So his answer to the conundrum is just make sexual selection bigger so it encompasses some of these things. Fair enough. It's definitely one way of getting around the mismatch. But there are others that have a problem with that. To simply say that sexual selection involves reproduction or concerns all aspects of sexuality is certainly to ignore Darwin's sense of the concept. I've already shown you that. Darwin thought it was about mating, so we would be certainly reframing sexual selection as something very different to what it started out as. And the other thing is, where does sexual selection stop then? Crypsis against predation or anti-predator strategies over the winter, are they just to allow females to breed again the next year? So they're to do with fecundity? So you can almost expand sexual selection to encompass everything if you use that framework. So it's kind of one of those things that seems comfortable to start off with, but to me raises other problems, because it's almost sexual selection is absolutely everything, because it's to do with surviving to your next breeding attempt. Another solution, Mary Jane West Eberhard, and that's going to be some of the focus, the main focus of the rest of the talk. She, noting these difficulties, came up with another framework, which she called social selection. So the key idea there is that anything to do with interactions between individuals would be social selection, and sexual selection would be part of it. So any forms of selection which involved competition or choice or interactions between individuals, that's social selection. And when the target of a competition or choice is something to do with matings and obvious sexual aspects, then that's sexual selection. So it's an expanded form of social selection in which is embedded sexual selection. So I'll go a little bit further into that and hopefully explain a little bit more how that might work. But I think it's quite a nice way at least of thinking of it, even if it's not adopted, because most people are uncomfortable with adding another term to the mix. It's at least a nice way of thinking how some of these variations between males and females could be conceptualized. That's a Wilson's Bird of Paradise, gorgeous thing from Waigeo Island off New Guinea. It's kind of the same colours as the schematic, but that's not to suggest that it's got a sexually selected mantle and a socially selected crown. No. It's totally sexually selected. It's a highly polygynous lek-based bird. And so there's no doubt about it that that's, you know, the ornaments of the male, they don't appear in the female. The ornaments of the male are supremely sexually selected. Nobody's going to argue that it sits in that red bit of the figure. But ornaments in winter, harrisser sparrows, badges of status, armaments and weapons, things that mediate competition for food in the non-breeding season. That's the kind of thing that Mary Jane West Eberhard would say, not really sure that is sexual selection. It's an ornament, but it occurs in social competition for non-sexual resources. So it would go in the blue bit. So that's just an indication of how you might subdivide social competition into different brackets in some useful kind of framework. Do we need it? Is it overcomplicating things? Well, I think it works very well for at least, you know, some components and subsets of ornaments in birds. You're not going to say that there's anything sexually selected about the red skin and plumage of young coots. That's obviously an ornament. You know, it's very similar in colour and operates in the same way. A choice-based system where the young compete for the attentions and provisioning of the adults. It's clearly an ornament of some kind, but nobody's going to frame it in sexual selection. But it fits very nicely into the choice or competition comparisons alternative mechanisms of social selection. It's obviously a socially selected ornament, but it's not really sexually selected. Nobody's going to argue that. Other examples are something close to my own heart. I did my PhD on European robins in the Cambridge Botanic Gardens years ago and realized at that time very well that female robins only sing in the winter. There is nothing, they never sing in the spring, they just stop singing and shack up with a male. But they do sing through the winter to defend solo territories. There's no way of framing that in sexual selection, but it's an ornament born and a cost borne by the female, which is nicely explained by social selection. The evolution of it might have been rooted in sexual selection, but you can't really explain the mechanism by which it continues to exist as a sexually selected trait. So social selection might provide a very useful framework in which we can conceptualize some of these more peripheral social traits. So here is a schematic of how that might work in the diagram that I presented before, with males at the bottom and females at the top, and all sorts of different types of components of fitness on the right. So this is going through 62 species that are well studied and working out in males versus females what the ornament is used for. And you can see in the bottom, the big M in the red, most male birds, well actually this isn't birds, this is across all taxa, a lot of them are birds, most of them are after matings or mates. So they get a huge big M, there's no doubt about it that sexual selection is explaining ornamentation in males very nicely, thank you very much. There's a few things that move more towards the social selection side of things. Foraging in the non-breeding season, non-breeding territories. Males use their songs or plumage ornaments for those kind of things, and that part of what their ornaments are used for is better conceptualized in sexual selection, but it's actually a pretty minor aspect in male biology. If we look at females, it changes rather a lot. One of the points to make here is I've put quite a lot of the different things, be they food related to reproduction or nest sites. These are things that are rather blurred, whether they're sexual selection or social selection, so I've just put them on the rim. But at least it gets across the idea that sexual selection still leaves, if we call everything sexually selected, it still leaves quite a lot of things which we're sort of assuming are sexually selected, but we don't really know. In broadening our idea to social selection, all social interactions, then we know that we've captured it. We know that that in there is what's happening, and then we admit a little bit more that we're not sure it's sexual selection. So that's more like the way I would prefer to frame it. It's not saying that we can easily discriminate between a social selection and a sexual selection. it's saying that in thinking about a broader sexual selection, we don't even have to decide one way or the other. We can leave that as an open question. So this kind of approach is very schematic and preliminary, but it's just to give the idea that a social selection idea, a social selection concept, is very useful for females, kind of useful for males as well, but it's really in females where it comes to the fore as possibly helping us to understand the differences, or at least be able to describe the differences between the sexes. It captures relevant processes very well, particularly in females. When we look at this across lots of different types of birds and other animals, we see that there's a kind of continuum. If we think of social selection from its sexual end to its non-sexual end, it's a big continuum in females. So at the left-hand end, things like the jacanas, sexual reversed species, the fish. There's no doubt about it that female ornaments in those cases are sexually selected. They're in the red bit of the diagram. And then you move a little bit further across to mutual sexual selection, a bit less to do with sexual selection, but still sexual selection, into female song, potentially female ornaments in the starlings, which may or may not be to do with attracting males or competing over males. They might have some other components in there, into things that are just about fecundity, or the motmots, which in which apparently, I'm struggling to believe it entirely, but apparently the ornament in the female motmot is just about anti-predator stuff. Or you've got the robins singing with the where the females only sing in winter. We know that's not to do with sexual selection. This is just to get the idea of a continuum, which if we just talk about sexual selection, we don't get a very good sense of. But if we think of social selection as this broader thing with a sexual and non-sexual component, we get a better idea of the variation of mechanisms of selection around us. Another way of looking at whether the ecological side of things, competition over ecological resources, is more important in females is to map it out like this. The little F's and M's at the bottom, is the left-hand big column, is showing that females are more often the one that's the ecological competition is most important in. On the right-hand side, very few species in our survey of the literature seem to be more ecologically are driven in the males than the females. So almost always the males in any system are interested in matings, and the females are more towards defending a territory, getting food for the young. So it's just showing that the consistency of that kind of underlying contrast between the sexes. It gets interesting in birds. Those are beautiful Gouldian finches. They're in their three different color morphs, and that is one of quite a few different systems of birds where signals are multi-purpose in both sexes. So both males and females are ornamented. Males select females on the basis of their plumage colors in these systems. And females also fight over, for instance, food in the non-breeding season using the same signals. So they're multi-purpose signals. Some of the purposes are sexual, some of them are non-sexual. So this is just to get across the idea that continuum from sexual to non-sexual across species also occurs within species across different seasons and across different contexts. So social selection can help us to get a bit of a better map about variation in function, I believe. A couple of other case studies. These are the birds I study mostly in Amazonia, or certainly used to. Ant birds, where the males and females both sing. Again, an interesting system, or it was quite illuminating to me to study these birds, where we found out that the male songs in ant birds are kind of like what people are used to in terms of songs of songbirds in the temperate zone. They're used to defend ecological resources, but unlike the temperate zone, it's all year round, so it's a very important ecological defense signal. And they're used outside the breeding season, unlike in the temperate zone. And often against other species, heterospecific. So those are several reasons why their functions extend beyond sexual selection and are best understood in their entirety in a framework like social selection. However, they are sexually selected as well, so It's very much a non-sexual and a sexual aspect to the signal, and that's a very common finding, these dual purpose ornaments. I'm seeing song as an ornament, by the way. Not everybody sees it like that, but it's a costly trait that is used in the same way as a plumage ornament. So makes sense to call it an ornament. Because of the use in ecological competition, some people have a problem calling that an ornament. They think of it as an armament, and that's a slightly different angle. I'm very happy just to call these costly traits ornaments, even though they have weaponry functions. Otherwise, it gets a little bit long-winded. In the same species of ant bird, the females sing and they duet with the male birds. So this is an interesting aspect that we've studied a bit. There's a sonograms on the bottom right, the top one showing the male-led kind of the pattern of duetting in our ant bird species. The male will sing, followed by the female, then there'll be a pause. The male will sing, followed by the female. That's how they do their stuff. And we use playback experiments to kind of just delve into the function of that duet. And one interesting finding is that if you play to a resident pair a duet from an intruding pair, they will be very coordinated in their response, which is shown in the second one down, where the male will sing a long song, and then the female with the green line above it will wait politely until the male is finished, and then she will sing with a flourish and beautiful coordination with the male. That's a very nice example of a kind of collaborative signal. They're cooperating over the defense of their territory. However, if you play the song of a solo female, then everything changes. It becomes a conflictual system, and the male tries to sing, and the female interrupts him almost immediately, whether that's to say to the newcomer female that, hey, this is my male, as you know, he's already bagged, so don't come this way, or she's trying to ruin his signal by some kind of signal jamming. Either way, she just talks over the top of him. Another interesting aspect is he doesn't like it. In the bottom sonogram, you can see that he starts his song, she starts to interrupt him, and he'll suddenly stop, waits till she's finished, and tries to sneak in another song, like breaking up the rhythm of the song. So there's a very nice system to look at how a duet, you know, there's something that could be conceived as this nice romantic thing, song between the sexes, can suddenly descend into kind of chaotic conflict between the male and the female. It's an example of how the females use their song, not only in cooperation, in terms of defending a territory, but also to protect their position in their long-term partnership. So these are flexible signals, and some of their functions are more ecological. Some are more social than sexual. And we need to understand, or I think we need a better language than sexual selection provides us to understand some of these variations. Can social selection, I've been arguing this, but here's just some examples about how social selection may help us to understand patterns of phenotypic evolution in birds. If we look at birds around us, what does social selection add that sexual selection didn't give us in the first place? So here's some examples of ones that that I think help to clarify why it might help us. So group living or cooperative species, that's often associated with female ornamentation in many bird families, shown very nicely by Irby and Dustin Rubenstein in African starlings. The idea there is that females may be ornamented like males monomorphically because they compete for access to mates, or it's either female-female competition for mates or some aspect of male choice. Either way, it could well be a very nice example of sexual selection on females. That may be the case, but do we know that? If it's cooperative, if cooperative territoriality is also an aspect of being cooperative, and those species that are cooperative are also the ones where females are territorial, then maybe it's the fact that they're using it in terms of intergroup rather than intra-group selection. So it's rather difficult to, if they were like the ant birds, then my suspicion would be that those signals are often used intergroup when they compete over territories. I don't know the extent to which cooperative African starlings are territorial versus non-cooperative being non-territorial, but my guess is that territoriality plays a role and that female ornamentation in those systems might be socially selected through competition between groups. So it might be that sexual selection is not the full answer anyway. What about female song? These are phylogenies of the New World blackbirds. And you have breeding latitude. So tropical species are marked in black on the right-hand side. It's the same tree mirrored. The tropical species are marked in black on the right, and the ones with female song are marked in black on the left. And you can see there's quite good concordance. These were things that are sort of thrown into the mix as, you know, female song or female ornamentation is linked to the tropics. Is it to do with some form of sexual selection? But if you think in terms of sexual selection and you mapped onto that year-round territoriality or female territoriality, you'd get almost the same thing. North temperate New World blackbirds don't tend to be tend to have territorial females, but those in the tropics defend territories just as the antbirds do that I described to you. The males and females cooperate over it. So from that perspective, female contribution or motivation to get involved with protecting the territory could entirely explain, through a social selection framework, why you get this pattern of more female ornamentation in the tropics. They defend, females are involved in defending territories mainly year-round because there's no big, strong winter that stops them doing it. So this might be a nice explanation. It's not to do with sexual selection, it might be just to do with a relaxation of social competition in north temperate New World blackbirds would explain why females would just lose their ornamentation in towards the poles. Sexual dichromatism, this kind of classic idea of sexual selection, you know, dichromatic things like the pheasants I showed at the outset. The more dichromatic or dimorphic bird species are, the stronger people think sexual selection is. And that mindset goes into some of these very similar studies. Here we have migratory species on the left being marked in black, and dichromatic species, again in New World blackbirds, there's a Bullock's Oriole for you, marked on the right, and there's a significant concordance or association between being migratory and being dichromatic. So papers like this raise the idea that maybe migratory behavior increases sexual selection, and why might that be? Again, I think that's not the right way, or potentially not the right way of looking at it. If migratory behavior is associated with non-territoriality in females, then I would say that being migratory and therefore non-territorial as a female just relaxes social selection on females. They're not competing. They're not using their plumage to defend territories, and they're not using song, so they become duller. And so it's not an increase in sexual selection; it's a decrease in social competition or social selection on females. That would be a more useful way of framing it, to my mind. But different people see these things in different ways. So I haven't shown you any real data, and I'll just touch on this for the mainly for the academics among you to see where we're going in terms of some of these ideas. It's not been my main focus lately, but here's stuff that we've been doing in terms of collecting information on bird song for the world's birds. Song is quite a useful way of saying, is something ornamented or not? Because it either sings or it doesn't. If you're thinking about plumage ornaments, is something ornamented or not? Is a patch, a color patch, an ornament? It's very difficult to really say what is an ornament, whereas song at least gives you a binary thing. You can say, it's got a song or it doesn't sing, so is it ornamented or not? And there is a map of data. This is sort of overlapped range maps, and whether they sing as a male is on the left. And these are global bird trees, about 10,000 species, with the male singers marked in green and the female singers marked in purple. We find that, you know, nearly 30% of the world's birds sing as females. This is after, you know, a few years of trawling the literature and listening to sound files on Zenocanto. The most recent publication suggested there's only 200 female singers. We always knew that there was more than that, but we've got up to about 3,000, and my suspicion is that there's probably 1,000 or 2,000 more in the tropics that we just don't know yet. So, you know, between a third and a half of the world's birds sing as females. Most people don't know that because we're just not used to it up in the north temperate zone. You don't come across it too much. Of course, there are Carolina wrens and other exceptions, but in the tropics, it's almost universal, or getting that way. if we map male singers in red, so the redness in the maps is where is a greater proportion of species sing as males. We can see that there's no real tropical bias, and things sing as males right up to the polar regions and far south. Females is a very different pattern, so the proportion of female singers is very much constrained to the tropics or Australia. So it's a kind of a classic pattern of the southern south temperate, tropical and south temperate pattern, whereas female song is very rare where we live, Britain and North America. So you can certainly see, just it's nice to actually see it visually represented. The proportion of female singers massively increases towards the equator, but why is that? I'm not going to really go into this in too much detail, but this is a nice data set to show the contrast of selection on males and females. The bottom is males, whether they have long-term stable bonds or year-round territoriality. Doesn't tell you that much about males. They can have both long-term bonds and territoriality, or they can have long-term bonds but no territoriality, and they basically all sing. They don't give a damn. They're going to sing no matter what. and if things are... even if things are... have no stable social bonds and no territoriality, so things like pheasants, that would come in that category, but that's not a very good example. And they do have kind of a song, kind of a mating call, or screaming pihas in South America. There's no stable social bond, there's no territoriality, but the male sings. So you can see that those kind of life history attributes don't really influence whether a male sings. But if you look at the top, there's quite a big difference. If you've got no stability and no territoriality, like those pihas and pheasants, you almost never sing as a female. There's no driver there. They're not interested in in finding a mate through their song. They're not motivated by what is probably two things: maintaining or protecting their position in a social partnership, like the female antbirds that I was describing, or defending their crucially important food resources in a territory for their offspring. That's at the left-hand end. Things with long-term bonds and year-round territory at the left, that's what really tells you whether a female's going to sing. And the next one is long-term bonds and no territoriality. Those two brackets produce a lot of female singers. If you take away particularly long-term social bonds, then females just drop out. They're not that interested in singing. So you can see just visually from that huge data set of 9,700 species that there's very different things going on in terms of mechanisms of selection targets of competition in the two sexes, supporting some of these ideas about how we might need a different framework to think about selection in females. So just to wrap up, ornaments evolve by increasing the fitness of the bearer, by improving access to some limiting resource, and that can be mates, but it can be lots of other things. The context is always social, to do with social competition, but it's not always sexual, and for that reason, there's a kind of groundswell of feeling that sexual selection doesn't quite make it or fit as a way of explaining or understanding ornamentation. And we need a little bit more of a nuanced framework that social selection can potentially provide, at least as a conceptual idea, and that framework is particularly important to apply to understanding ornamentation in females. Thanks to this lot for helping out with some of those analyses at the end there and some of the funding. And thanks to everybody for listening in. Thank you.
We have some time for questions.
Happy to deal with any questions.
Ben. Joe, do you think it's more common when a female has more ornament that she's using for social competition that it would have
Yeah, so you'd imagine the latter. Certainly with song, we know that even in species where only males sing, you just inject testosterone into a female and they will sing as well. So the genetic coding and the behavior is kind of there but latent. So this is really looking at what it is that prompts natural levels of high testosterone or natural evolution of a behavior that's hidden but can be expressed. So yes, I'd say that it's not evolving de novo. Certainly with song, it's something that's at least very close to being there, and it's something that would be very easily switched on by a particular context. Female plumage traits are a little bit different because there's a lot of species where they're quite different from the male ornaments, and I think there you're talking about somewhat different pathways, probably genetically very similar, probably the same loci involved, but they're just under different selection and going in different directions. So that would be my feeling along those lines.
Oh, go ahead. For birds, the like crows, for both the males and the females, look exactly the same, and they have no obvious markings.
Yeah.
How do they choose a mate?
How do they choose one? That's a really good question, yeah. Clever things like crows, there's probably a lot of kind of close range interactions, and I don't know whether you've heard this, but quite a lot of crows have quite complex songs when you get close to them. You don't hear it very much, but I've heard ravens and jays a lot. You know, you get these kind of quiet sub-songs that they give. I don't really know much about the extent to which they're choosing mates with that, but I know that they don't always just give their simple vocalization. So there's something more going on. Not a lot is known about it. It's quite a good question. They're certainly not using plumage ornaments, are they? So yeah, it's a good question. Oh, yeah. Go for that one. She was first, I think.
I have two questions, actually.
Okay.
Is it possible that there's a predator aspect of this, too? For some of the colors we may look at as being ornamentation, could there be a connection to that with predators? And then the other question is, with cowbirds, you know, they don't really fit the mode. Is there some other angle that might bring into an analysis, since they're sort of not the norm?
Can I ask you to repeat the question for the people online? They can hear you.
Okay, so let's try and do the first question, which was, it's gone. Jet lag, I blame jet lag.
My first question was if the coloration has something to also do with predators.
Yeah, so is that... Yeah, so the question is it aposomatic coloring? Is it some kind of signal to a predator to dissuade a predator from attacking? And certainly some animal signals seem to be of that type. You know, the white undertail of moorhens and other rallids there's some evidence that it's a signal to show alertness to a predator. That's not so much of an ornament. I don't think when it gets to the level of, you know, colorful plumage patches, or certainly song. There's no real information that's to do with anti-predator stuff, apart from in some rare cases where some birds in Papua New Guinea have toxic plumage and they've got somewhat aposomatic, they're called pitahuis, and they have a little bit more aposomatic plumage, which is the thinking goes is communicating to a predator that they're distasteful. So that's a bit more like a frog. It's like a bird frog. But in most cases, I would say that ornaments, plumage ornaments in birds and certainly song, are not to do with predators. Then your second question was about cowbirds.
Yeah,
could you repeat that?
They don't really fit the norm, so I always look at them and wonder sort of where they fit into the equation.
Why do they not fit the norm?
Well, they lay their eggs on other birds' nests.
Oh, yeah.
Their own young. I don't know what the correct term for it is with entomology.
Yep.
So I'm just wondering if by looking at something that's not the norm,
yeah,
that give you more insight into.
I think all that I would say about cowbirds is because they are brood parasites, females don't have any territory to defend, so it fits what I was saying. Female cowbirds are brown, they're not ornamented, they don't sing really, they sing a bit, actually. So I don't really understand why they sing, to be honest. they don't quite fit in that way, but certainly their plumage is brown and not glossy and showy. So they fit the general idea because females aren't protecting a territory. Males, they still need to mate with the female, so they are kind of normal in that way. So they have glossy, shiny plumage, and they sing pretty complex songs because they want females to choose them. So to me, the male seems like quite normal. The female's a bit different because it has no territory at all, and it doesn't even have to defend food resources for its young. So it has no compunction to be ornamented at all, as far as I can see. That's how I'd see cowbirds differing. And the way they look kind of fits what you'd predict from what I've been saying.
Recently, when we started using spectrophotometer to look at birds, we've started to realize that some of the species that we used to think were not sexually dichromatic
Yeah.
are sexually dichromatic in the UV spectrum.
Yeah.
How is that changing, I guess, changing the understanding of this complex? Because before we had pieces where you thought, okay, this might be social selection, there's no clear difference, there's no ornamentation, but now there might be ornamentation, and we just haven't seen it before.
Yeah. I think, okay, so this is a question about plumage signals in birds. So, in the slide after that showed the importance of year-round territoriality. That tends to be in slightly more humid areas where there's resources like fruit and insects and nectar-providing flowers year-round. That'll give the life history attributes of species. Sorry, I didn't repeat the question. it's been a long day. I think you heard that one anyway. So my feeling would be in those sort of seasonally variable, often semi-arid environments, you're not getting those, you're getting nomadic species or seasonally mobile species where females don't have the attributes that we identify as really important for singers. So I think that's an actual real finding rather than we don't know about the birds there. There aren't many female singers there because they tend to not have very long social bonds or year-round territoriality because they're kind of grassland or thorn veld things, most of them anyway. So I think that's a real pattern. Does that make sense? Not so happy about that.
We have one question.
Can I finish with two questions from folks online who are sending questions during the talk?
Go ahead.
One is from a person raising hand from Toronto. If a song is an ornament, how does the ability to learn a new dialect in species like Amazons fit on the sexual social spectrum?
Parrots are a rather tricky one. That's obviously, people don't really understand mimicry in parrots and they have such a huge array of vocalizations. And I would love to know more. I'm often, gobsmacked, dumbstruck in the rainforest, listening to the complexity of some of these Amazons calling in the canopy, and I have very little idea what they're communicating about. They often sit in groups, so it's not males and females communicating with each other. It's certainly not territorial. They'll sit in groups and garble and babble and warble and learn different song types from each other. I think we're moving into the world of parrots that might be a little bit difficult to pin down. It's something to do with social interactions. There's something possibly to do with mate choice. So I'd say it was likely to be sexual rather than social because they're not territory holders particularly. If they use it over, females use it over protecting a nest hole, it might get a little bit more blurry. But my feeling is that it's either sexual or just parrot stuff that we don't understand very well.
one last question from a person online in Michigan, I believe. Are there certain types of ecological roles or environments in which these types of ornamentations would tend not to develop? For example, most North American raptor species do not have significant male-female plumage differences. Would the fact that they are predatory or similar aspect bear on that?
So ornamentation in raptorial species, why would they not be ornamented? Yeah, obviously there's lots of differences across different groups. I think in some raptorial species there's natural selection for a certain degree of crypsis, so they're not easy to spot when they're perched. They do of course have elaborate or what you'd call costly flight displays, so I think what might have been an ornament would have been more costly in a predator because that makes them more conspicuous to their prey. So they do things like squeal calls and flight displays. So my impression of that would just be that the function of the ornament is just shifted onto things that they can switch on and off rather than bear all the time. So that's how I would explain that.
Okay, great. Well, with that, let's thank Joe one more time.
Thank you very much.